Okay, so thank you for coming today. The talk, as you would have seen, is entitled Vygotsky, Cultural Historical Activity Theory, Reimagining Methodologies and Critical Perspectives on Learning Development in Communities. My name is Peter Sochik. I'm a professor here of adult education in Leadership, Higher and Adult Education Department at OIC. And I'm pleased to welcome our two speakers today. To introduce them briefly, Eduardo Viana is an associate professor at the Department of Social Science at LaGuardia Community College of the CUNY City University of New York system. He was born and raised in Brazil. This is where Eduardo, I learned recently, earned his medical degree and then completed his residency in child psychiatry. He eventually went on to complete a PhD in developmental psychology at CUNY Graduate Center, where he met Anna Stetsenko, who I'll talk about in a moment. He was recognized there with a prestigious President's Scholarship at CUNY Graduate Center. And he went on to be recognized also at the ARA for Early Career Award in Cultural Historical Research. His work is inspired, as we'll learn a little bit more about today, by Vygotsky and Cultural Historical Psychology, the Dialectics of Youth, Development, and Social Justice, as well as Critical Pedagogy. His teaching, research, and publications have focused on the intersection between teaching, learning, and development in various settings that serve underprivileged populations, such as those in child welfare programs, substance abuse recovery support programs, as well as public schools. These themes are, beautifully reflected in his book, a recent book, Collaborative Transformations in Foster Care: Teaching Learning as a Developmental Tool in Residential Programs, published by Berlag 2009. His many other publications appear in a range of collections and leading journals in the area of, again, critical studies of youth, learning, and development. And over the years, he's produced a distinctive, and I would say, exhilarating perspective on the notion of critical and theoretical teaching and learning and critical theoretical knowledge. One effort in particular, which I think we're going to hear about today in the second half of our prepared comments, deals with a project he's led focusing on peer activist community learning research. But we're actually going to start our session with Anna Stetsenko. She'll speak first. Anna is a professor of developmental psychology at Graduate Center, City University of New York. She's the former head of that program for almost 10 years. She also currently holds appointments in graduate studies at Urban Education and the Center for the Study of Women and Society. She received her doctorate at Moscow State University, carried out research at the University of Moscow before moving to Berlin to take a postdoctoral research fellowship at the Max Planck Institute. We could kind of go on forever about these things, posts she's held. Visiting fellow at the Center for Cultural Studies in Vienna, as well as also a professor of developmental psychology at the University of Bern, Switzerland. Publishes in a variety of languages. Many people will know her area of expertise in cultural historical activity theory and its application to education, focusing especially on issues of learning and development, the self, agency, identity, and cultural mediation. Some of her latest publications include Theorizing Personhood, for the World in Transition and Change, Reflections from a Transformative Activist Stance, from Martin and Beckhardt's Psychology of Personhood, 2013, very recent. Personhood, an Activist Project on Historical Becoming through Collaborative Pursuits of Social Transformations in New Ideas of Psychology, 2012. Standing on the Shoulder of Giants, a Balancing Act of Dialectically Theorizing Conceptual Understandings on the Grounds of Vygotsky's Project in Restructuring Science Education, 2010. And then finally, because we could go on for a while here, a collaborative effort with Eduardo entitled Connecting Learning and Identity Development Through a Transformative Activist Stance, Application in Adolescent Development and Child Welfare Programs from the Journal of Human Development. Anyway, so instead of taking up all the time going through some of these achievements, I think I'd like to pass it over now to Anna, and then we'll transition right to Eduardo, and we'll save 20 minutes to a half hour for open discussion, so prepare your comments, and I'll be passing the mic around then. So please join me in welcoming Anna Stetsenko and Eduardo Viana.
I don't know. otherwise, yes, I'm used to talking while not sitting. So hello, thank you for coming, and it's a great pleasure to be here, and thank you to Peter especially for inviting us. It's a great pleasure, the University of Toronto, and specifically this institute, has a very good reputation. You guys are very well known in many parts of the world. So it's a pleasure and honor to be here. So my talk will be the first part, and I'm planning to take probably about 45 minutes. So you saw the title here, and Peter has announced the title. If I were to say most exactly what I want to talk about is, that would be talking about theory from a transformative stance, and really zooming in and focusing on the transformative approach to theory and to learning and development, and using theory as a tool of transformation. So the rationale, basically, of what I want to talk about today is what I see as the need to interrogate and reconstruct broad philosophies and theories underpinning research on learning and development to develop tools for new sociopolitical agendas today, because the world is rapidly changing. I think we need new approaches at the policy levels, at political, ethical levels, and for that we need to also reconstruct and reimagine a lot of philosophical underpinnings and the foundations of what we take to be theories of development. So I basically think we need alternative, ideologically non-neutral conceptions of human condition and human development and nature, but reconstructed along the lines of anthropolitics, not in the traditional sense, because many people will shudder at the notion of human nature that taken in the old tradition. I'm talking about is really this work of theorizing human condition in line with understanding social situatedness and historical, political situatedness of knowledge and theories. So the punchline, basically, of what I want to present and talk about is about theorizing social change and activism as being part of the human condition. This has not been done before. I don't think this has been emphasized enough in the mainstream, especially theories of human development, the emphasis on seeing human beings as agents and actors of social change and transformation, and seeing activism as being part of human condition. So that is about moving and shifting away from, not away, but together with the notion of participation, but shifting to the level of looking at processes of transformation. So the new perspectives for education in the changing world. It's basically another title, could be another title for my presentation today. And this is building on many, many works in the field today. This is a continuation and expansion of Vygotsky's and cultural historical activity theory approach. Why I'm really passionate about us together doing the work of reconceiving and reconstructing human development and learning is because I think, and I have a quote here from Albert Einstein, no less than Albert Einstein, who said that we can't solve problems by using the same kind of thinking we used when we created them. So, very often, I think we still underappreciate the role of broad themes and broad ways of thinking about human development and learning. And the other quote I like personally very much, and I find it useful in thinking about those issues, is that the real difficulty in changing the course of any enterprise lies not in developing new ideas, or not so much, I would say, in developing new ideas, but in escaping old ones. That's a very paradoxical statement, but it's. I think personally that often we have wonderful developments in the field of human development and in the field of learning and development, and yet these new novel discoveries, insights, ideas, they come together packaged with the older premises and notions. And then, of course, it's a little bit tricky to really move forward if we don't leave the older ones behind, in a certain sense, which I will try to explain. This was a quote from Keynes. So my work is in the genre of practical philosophy, what I think would be called philosophy of practice, which connects, of course, with works of many scholars in the past, such as John Dewey, but also Lev Vygotsky. Vygotsky was doing the kind of work which you could name practical philosophy. So not abstract formulas, but sets of historically situated and sociopolitically contingent tools for collaborative practices. And therefore, to repeat basically what I said before, we need concepts of development and learning that are developed alongside critical revisions of ideological, ethical, political groundings of previous systems. And when I work with these issues, certainly it is about science and political discourses and institutions at the same time. So the trick is to connect the two, which I think Vygotsky was doing also. Maybe never saying these words, maybe not using these particular formulations, yet doing this kind of work. So this is about critical questioning of neoliberal orthodoxies and their historical conditions and philosophies that they had spawned. Another quote which summarized nicely what I've been recently thinking about and working on is from Jameson, a Marxist scholar, who said that to grasp Marxism as rather, it's important to grasp Marxism as rather different than a philosophical system, although it is a philosophical system. As Jameson says, it's an as yet unnamed conceptual species. One can only call a unity of theory and practice, which by its very nature and structure stubbornly resists assimilation to the older philosophical system. It's a big conundrum as to how do we understand this, the broad philosophy of Marxism, which I think is needed in the new, in understanding Vygotsky, in understanding contemporary developments in educational processes as well. Before I go into more detailed discussion of what I want to present today, this is one more quote from an indigenous scholar, Linda Tuhiwai Smith, from the book Decolonizing Methodologies, Research and Indigenous Peoples. And she wrote, "The principle of humanity was one way in which the hidden rules could be shaped. To consider indigenous peoples as not fully human or not human at all enabled distance to be maintained and justified various policies of either extermination or domestication." So when we want to use the concept of human nature, of human condition, of humanity, as the broad topics that I think need to be reinvigorated, of course we have to be very careful about the legacies that come with those notions. But I think that rather than making human nature and the concept of human nature obsolete, this painful history, in fact, demands that it be reconstrued on radically new foundations underpinned by alternative socio-political ethos. So, the issue of human nature and human condition, broadly conceived, I think is very important. So what I will talk very briefly about is first drawing attention to what I call the grand synthesis, and you see I use it with irony, the grand synthesis of sociobiology, cognitivism, and brain research. I do want to discuss briefly that the relational worldview, where I think the works and contributions of many scholars in education and human development, such as, ironically, Piaget, Dewey, and Vygotsky, all converge and really speak to the same topic, the relational worldview, where they have much in common. And then I want to proceed from there to transformative activist stance, taking Vygotsky's approach and situating it in contemporary conditions which we find ourselves in today, with the particular sociopolitical and cultural challenges that need to be considered if we want to apply the theory in the first place. So, mainstream theories of human development, I will go through this very, very quickly because I'm sure it's all very familiar to you. But the focus is still on the isolated individual. The mind is still understood as an information processing device. Human beings are understood as passive, adapting to the status quo. And of course, teaching learning follows a transmission model. This is very familiar, I'm sure. If we were to come up with a metaphor of learning and development in mainstream psychology today, that's the metaphor. It's really an isolated, naked individual, as it were, basically, devoid of cultural influences, not situated in context. That is the prime topic of research and thinking in mainstream traditional approaches that are still powerful today. And that's what I take to be a new grand synthesis of cognitivism, sociobiology, evolutionary psychology, brain research, and transmission-based pedagogy. They have joined forces today. They are unprecedentedly strong today. And I think we overlook sometimes how powerful they are becoming today, kind of in the last 10 or 20 years, sweeping the landscape and taking unprecedented power and influence. Mind is considered to be an internal player, neurons, and especially two last decades, it's these were the decades of brain and automaticity. So the traditional approaches, if they were previously concerned with this naked, isolated individual, today they are not, that even the individual is gone, it's just brain, naked brain. So that's what's happening. If we look around, we see this tsunami of these works really sweeping the landscape, unfortunately, with very unfortunate implications. And there is, I don't think, enough resistance to this trend, because the sociocultural approaches, the approaches which I broadly call sociocultural, on the other side of the spectrum, they're disconnected. They don't know about each other very often. They're not joining ranks. They're not coordinating their work so that the scholars of Dewey and the scholars of Vygotsky, for example, are not in dialogue, and there isn't enough coordination to really present an alternative to what is becoming research into brain. So of course the notion of mind in this research on brain is actually inherited from the 17th and 18th century, not even pre-Darwinian actually. So not only 19th century, but really much earlier, pre-Darwinian philosophy and worldview that underpin the traditional approaches. And we cannot underestimate the impact of the new wonder machine, the fMRI techniques that allow to look inside the brain, and that's very appealing metaphors and pictures that sway people to think that we find the answers in the brain, which we cannot. And of course, this research and this movement of this new grand synthesis, it does support the very traditional social roles and warrants for competition, passivity, selfishness, social inequalities. So if you read champions of this traditional approach, such as Steven Pinker, you will see that it comes packaged with very traditional conservative ideology that is not even hidden very much there. So, by the way, I'd like to show just the pictures of what the kind of worldview is underpinning the traditional research. It's the mechanical worldview with, we see here, John Locke and David Hume, and this is René Descartes and Einstein. I'd like to show this picture just to get a sense of how old these theories are, and yet they're used as the ones that are believed to be applicable and working in today's theories and research on human learning and development, which is sometimes it's useful to see the phases, well, and the weeks, and the way, you know, that it really comes from yesterday, not even yesterday, but long ago. So today's alternatives, and that this is what I want to focus much more on, because I assume, of course, we probably are sharing much of the critique of the traditional approaches, but today's alternatives in human development and learning are represented by theories that focus on distributed, socially situated, dynamical, contextualized, dialogical, co-constructed, participatory, and embodied and acted processes. These are the alternatives to the mainstream brain-focused transmission kind of model. These are, each of these terms stand for a whole direction of research, partly in psychology, partly in education, and they are pretty disconnected, but they have much in common. That's what I think is important to draw attention to. Each of them, of course, I could have lots of references to each of these approaches. The metaphor that connects them and which underlines much of this work in today's approaches is the metaphor of participating in the world. So, and it's premised on the notion of being there or dwelling in the world. So the notion of participation, if we look at works by Leib and Wenger, and many, many others, and I know Eduardo will also talk about that, they really have the metaphor of participation rather than isolated processes. So this is about relational worldview. This is where I think Piaget, Dewey, and Vygotsky, among many others, by the way, they intersect. And they have this in common, absolutely. If we read it carefully, we can see that at the core is the notion of transactional processes between the human being and the world that are back and forth exchanges that connect people to the world through engagement and participation. So the key notions then are those of co-evolution, continuous dialogue and participation, relatedness and interconnectedness, the coming together of individuals and the world that transcends their separation. So this is a summary of many very powerful insights that come from Piaget, Dewey, and Vygotsky, and they are about transactional processes that happen in between the human being and the world and really transcend their separation. And that's one of the most difficult insights and messages to get across when we teach, I guess you have similar experiences of teaching developmental psychology and education today, to get across this notion that we cannot look at the human being separately from the world. We need to look at the connection and the processes that happen at the meeting point. That takes a lot of readings and a lot of thinking for people who begin to study those topics to situate themselves in this perspective. So then, according to it, what develops is not a person alone, but the full situation of organism-environment interaction. This could be a quote from Dewey, Piaget, or Vygotsky. All of them said those exact words. Okay, which is amazing then when they are completely juxtaposed and contrasted as if there is nothing in common. That is this powerful core in their works. So there is no human being prior to or outside of active engagement with the world, including with other people. And people have access to reality through engaging with and participating in it. And mind is a dynamic system carried out as actions by individuals who, through these actions, realize and actualize their relations to the world and to other people. Broad definitions, they're very important and useful because they really represent an alternative to the individual-focused, traditional brain-focused research. So if these premises are taken seriously, really, there is no way back to just looking at the brain, isolated brain, which unfortunately happens too often. So the relational view, some people use this even picture to demonstrate the flow, the continuous flow between the person and the world. I'm not sure it's the best picture to illustrate, but it's hard to capture this really powerful notion of the transactional flow. So that is useful. So among the perspectives that use the transactional worldview and the transactional metaphor of participation are approaches such as constructivism and social constructionism, critical social theory and critical pedagogy, Vygotsky's approach, activity theory and actor network theory, dynamic systems theory, distributed and situated cognition approach, many approaches in cultural anthropology such as works by Tim Ingold and many others, and also in developmental biology and epigenetics. It's exciting to see the same developments along the lines of transactional worldview, where unlike evolutionary psychology, it's an evolutionary approach in biology and epigenetics where there is a much more dynamic and fluid view, where genes do not dictate any outcomes in a predeterministic view. This is something that has to be repeated again and again, I think, due to how important this message is. So to quote Esther Thielen, for example, at the dynamic systems approach, just to give you a flavor, that's the approach that perhaps is less known in developmental, in the research on education and teaching and learning, but her works represent a very powerful synthesis of the ideas from transactional worldview, and she speaks about how really this is a revolution in developmental approaches and in psychology, basically. Or she speaks about how new theoretical and conceptual tools have swept away old ways of thinking and brought the promise of a developmental synthesis. And the emphasis on developmental is extremely important. because it's about nothing being fixed ever and everything developing in the processes of transactions with time. So, according to dynamic systems approaches, development is the product of the child's everyday and continual efforts to make things happen in the world. That's the best definition of development, by the way. Well, it's not full answer, but this is an important milestone in just thinking about how children develop. Development is the product of the child's everyday, continual efforts to make things happen in the world. And the patterns arise from the confluence of organisms' features or characteristics and those of the environment, and there are no programs dictating those patterns. So nothing is predetermined. Everything is open. That open-ended system, dynamic processes, with no programs, not from genes, not from brain, dictating anything. It all comes to continuous work and effort every day. However, yes, and that's the transition to what I think can be done today, more in line with transactional approaches, but kind of taking them to the next level and making the next step. I think in transactional approaches, including in works by Piaget, Dewey, and Vygotsky, even Vygotsky, but Vygotsky, we need to look closely at that, but there is a deep influence of Darwinian views on many participatory approaches. The goal of development, according to Piaget and Dewey, for example, is to adapt to and fit in with the world as it is, in its givenness. The mind is seen as an organ of adaptation. These are, could be quotes from either Piaget or Dewey, or from many people who work in the Dewey and Piagetian approaches today. So not in Dewey, not in Piaget so directly, but the survival and biological fitness, competition and struggle, natural selection, these are still metaphors applied in theories of human development and learning, even those that use transactional approaches. So the ethical dimension then are not central, and they're not easily explained from this position. There are important postmodernist alternatives that are different from the transactional worldview, but they connect to it on many levels. But the postmodernist alternatives in general, I think, have been, especially in the past years, decades, have been operating from within the notion of end of history metaphor. During the era after the end of the Cold War, where broad social projects were considered to be unattainable, and in the period of from 90s, especially from 91. I think one can note, at least that's what I've done in my work recently, a certain lack of political imagination and vision and commitment to large social projects. And the point we're left with is the relativism of knowledge and relativism of truth and direction, with the issue and conundrum that is not resolved within and cannot be resolved within the transactional worldview only. And of course, we have a general suspicion of grand theories, a suspicion of the notion about notion of human nature and human condition, which sociocultural scholars write very rarely about. So the teachers and the people who work in education, they look to biologically reductivist theories for answers. And we are not giving these answers because we often don't go that way and do not take this path. So we are neglecting to relativize relativism itself, as we discussed with Peter just the other day. The problem today, I think, is that a lot of theories are still wedded to the notion of status quo rather than social change. Whereas, of course, the time in which we are situated calls for understanding human development as embedded in this rapidly changing world where nothing is fixed and the status quo is not a given, which is a contradiction in terms, but where we might want to imagine the changes in the status quo rather than the adaptation, rather than just the metaphor of being in the world with its status quo. So in the present What is in the present is seen as separate from the past and the future. And the is and the ought are disconnected in the transactional worldview. And there is not much of a discussion there. One of the notions I think is in need of being problematized is the notion of the future. In the transactional and relational perspectives, the future is projected as a continuation of the given, rather than problematized, because social change is not taken as very central to our notions of human nature. So, if we look around at theories of human development, there is very little engagement with the notion of the future, of how the problematizing of this notion and of the time scale of development can help us understand development as and learning as transformative processes rather than only transactional. So this is then in line of my work that I term the framework which I'm developing, I term a transformative activist stance, which is built on Vygotsky's model, and as expansion of this model, which continues the works in transactional in the framework and takes many, many insights from there and builds on them, so they're not discarded. The development is seen as a relational and transactional process. And yet, so it's on development as understood as a fully relational process. But yet, different sets of premises are put up front. As Vygotsky, that's why I take Vygotsky, not just because he comes from the same country as I do, but I think he also focuses much more than other transactional theories on collectivity and collaboration, on contribution in place of participation, or at least he gives the grounds to develop those notions. So, and political imagination and commitment to the goals and activism, social activism as commitment to certain future, the goals for development as a central standpoint. That's what is I believe is important in the transformative activist stance. So it's about theorizing social change as constitutive of development and learning, rather than, not instead of, but together with the transactional. So in the Vygotskyan tradition, I think the following points can be highlighted usefully. First of all, in just really strong contestation of biological metaphors of development of adaptation, humans are seen as not biologically adapted to the world, but rather are adapted to not being adapted to anything that is pre-given or fixed. We can find this in Dewey too, to some extent, but then the notion of transforming the world through pulling efforts together, the collaborative effort, amplifying each other's abilities for action in constructing the communal world, including through the use of cultural tools, so then collectively invented ways of being in the world, is the central key point for development and learning in the transformative activist stance. So it's about transformation rather than transaction then. And it's about contribution rather than participation. These are tacit shifts, conceptual shifts, but they're very meaningful. And they entail a lot of implications at the level of teaching and learning and understanding human development. So what is central to the notion of transformative activist stance is the process not of reacting to the world, but dynamically changing existing circumstances within communities as these are enacted and invented. You can sense here, of course, an influence. Those of you who are Marxist scholars might sense here continuation with a Marxist framework, which of course was very central to Vygotsky. So we can say that a number of transactional theories, such as Dewey and Piaget, whereas they were built mostly within the framework of Darwinian approach, which was powerful at the time, by the way. Consider the time when the theory was created. But Darwin had an incredible, held incredible sway over scholars of education and human development for many decades and up until today, and but especially at the early 20th, during the early 20th century. But for Vygotsky, Darwin was extremely important, but yet it was Marx and the philosophical system of Marx that gave the major impetus for conceptualizing development and learning through the notion of communal transformative practice in place of transaction. And what was also central and needs to be emphasized today was that the social processes and practices of human development were seen as goal-directed and purposeful, that is, premised on imagination of the future and commitment to bringing this future into realization. From which I think it can be distilled that human development and learning have to do with active position, vision for the future. So that's the key notion here in the transformative activist stance, taken from the lineage of Marx / Darwin. By the way, they had much in common also. You can discern a number of important commonalities there at one level. At another level, there are important differences. So through Marx to Vygotsky and to the notions I think that are needed today when we deal with the processes that are constantly changing more rapidly than ever in the past. So the centrality of the future then is something I really want to draw attention through this work. And I use Bakhtin's work here that are not often emphasized enough, I think, in theories of human development. They are emphasized in education. But in human development, what for me stands out is the notion of the future. This is the quote from Bakhtin. The center of gravity in the world is located in the future, in what is desired, in what ought to be, and not in the givenness of an object, not in its present, but envisioned beforehand as something that ought to be. That's one of the ways to formulate this point, is to say that human beings, by virtue of being human, always act from within their life agendas and visions for the future, from what they believe or think ought to be, and are thus activists whose beliefs and commitments are critically embodied in every act of speaking and knowing, and every act of being and doing. And there is of course, a number of works that have discussed this dichotomy of is and ought, and works by Bottomer, for example, and others. But what I think needs to be done more is to bring these notions to our discussions of human development in the foundational principles of human development and learning. I use a lot of feminist work to support this direction and this framework of research, and I use work, for example, by Marilyn Fry, who doesn't speak in exactly the same terms or notions, but I liked it when she wrote that just as walking requires something firm to stand on, so being an actor in the world requires a foundation, a commitment to where you want to get. Without that, we don't know how to be or how to act. Without that, we can't move. Well, that connects for me to this expansion of notions of development through transformative activist stance. I use often the examples of perception for people who are not in psychology. Maybe these are useful examples to show that any process, any aspect of human mind, even putatively, very simple processes such as perception that are supposed to be almost mechanical in the traditional vision, that we are bombarded with stimuli and we see them because they're there and they're just reflected in the mind or the brain. But of course there is no, according to the transactional perspective, and already in the works of Piaget and Dewey, there are no picture-like internal representations of the outside world. And seeing is always a way of acting in the environment. But what I need to be added to this is that the goals and purposes are central in any act of perception. Yes, is it 5 minutes? Oh, thank you. Yes. So then even perception is impossible without a vision for the future. That's a counterintuitive claim, which has very many implications for how we understand development and learning. As we see the world based on where we want to go next. That's different from the transactional perspective per se. So we can't see unless we know what we want to do next. Physiologically, actually, quite literally, we become blind. This can be shown through the research in psychology. I'll skip certain things. As I said before, contribution is very important here because it assumes an active stance and the vision for where you want to go next as underpinning what happens in the present. There is much to be said here. I mean, I won't be able to present all the arguments in favor of this position, so I can give you some kind of pointers in the direction of in which I'm going. Of course, a lot of it has been published, so if you're interested, you can look up some of these works. So, from this position, that speaks to, of course, works also in the Marxist and feminist tradition. The activities, and that's a connection to activity theory, the activity of purposefully transforming the world is human nature. So when we need the notion of human nature, and that's the notion which overturns so many of the brain-focused individual, isolated, individual person-focused approaches. So then this makes the notions of life agendas and collective projects and visions central to us conceiving which the transactional approaches, including even the recent ones and the participatory frameworks, don't have. Because participation is about being there. By the way, being there is the title of the book, very well-known book by Andy Clark, Being There. Well, it says a lot. It's just about being there, not changing, not transforming, just being there, as if it's enough to just be there. And the notion of participation, unfortunately, goes very often in this direction. It's enough to be there in the community and to participate. And that's a lot. It is a powerful message as well. But it's not enough. If we don't see also how human beings are contributing to the social collaborative processes and practices happening in the here and now. There are interesting links to Marxist works here, to feminist works, very many. So I'm talking about agency and activism as natural conditions for human beings, their nature. So for example, when a judge such as Supreme Court judge such as Sonia Sotomayor, who was elected not long ago, you know, probably 2 or 3 years ago, and she was accused of being partisan and being biased because of her history of being a minority woman, the first one on the Supreme Court in the United States. He was accused of being biased and prejudiced. Well, I mean, these are the issues where the perspective that explains how human beings are always partisan, by the way, and biased. Always, because that is the human natural condition. And there is no other way, at least in a number of ways. So it's about works on agency, and I'll skip here. And of course, I just want to say that there are no connotations to instrumental control over nature. It's not about mastering nature, because this work can be taken in this meaning. But this is why I also went into a lot of works in ecological materialism and feminism to really reconstrue the notion of the transformative processes where we are active agents. in the nature, so without falling back into the traps of instrumental control over nature, and so on. So there is a lot to be said about the centrality of teaching learning in this perspective, but I'll have to skip a number of things. Moving to summary then. So the transformative activist stance then is about taking account and really looking into the necessity, the need of authentic position from which we learn about existing structures and our world, and how learning occurs really through one struggle of becoming, a struggle to matter within dynamically unfolding social practices. And yet that is also not all. Okay, that could be, yeah, and I think Eduardo will refer to some of those things in continuation, because his work really embodies this approach in a very wonderful, practical way. So we go from a very abstract notions here presented today, but really into practice of, in line with this notion of practical philosophy, to see the practical philosophy enacted in research. But I would say that's a nice way to summarize maybe here. So if we just look at Piaget, Dewey, and Vygotsky and transformative activist stance. And by Piaget, by the way, I mean a lot of constructivist approaches. So they're here used as stand-ins for a number of works, not just of their own works. So it is also for Dewey, a lot of research in inquiry, learning approaches, and so on. So for Piaget, the learners are scientists, really, the scientists who explore the world through independent experimentation and learning as elaboration of logical schemas in the mind. That's really the crux of Piaget, a lot of works on social constructivism. For Dewey, learners are workers. That's much more practical, much more embedded, much more situated approach. And learners are workers acquiring practical habits and skills through experience to solve practical problems, an incredibly powerful, important insight. Yet for Vygotsky and from the transformative activist stance, without canceling this notions, but taking them to another level, learners are and teachers are social activists who work out goals and strive to fulfill a mission, which is a very contested notion, by the way, the mission, of course. But and I'll skip here, and maybe I'll just say one last thing. Yes. Okay. There are many practical lessons here for education and for teaching and learning. And that's the last slide. That's probably the 5 minutes ahead. So that education can be conceived of as an extensive activist project. The work of educators and teachers can be conceived as such, because it's about providing conditions and tools for students to author their knowledge and their history, and thus their future, as the critical task of education. What is central here is the notion of allowing the students access and giving access to tools of developing commitments and passions and wonder to contributing to society, to learn to be passionate. So when our students are passionate, we know they're learning. If they're not passionate, they're not learning, actually. I hope you're a little bit passionate today. I certainly am, and I now leave the microphone to for Professor Vianna. Yes, thank you.
So again, thank you very much. Thank you, Peter, for inviting us. Thank you for being here. So what I'm planning to talk about is how I am developing with Anna a transformative activist research approach. So I'm going to talk about the examples of two research projects that I have engaged in, but the focus will be actually on the first one, because I'm not going to have time so much to get to the second one. So So basically, I'll be talking about the practical relevance of theory, and actually there's a dual epigraph to my talk, which is, I could start with Kurt Lewin's famous aphorism that there's nothing more practical than good theory, And Anna complimented that very keenly, saying that there's nothing more theoretical than good practice. So I think that it's a good transition from her talk to my talk. So I'm going to talk about how the cultural historical activity theory approach, expanded by a transformative activist stance, has guided my practical endeavors in education and research and research in other institutions. And I'll first start with the research that I carried out in a child welfare residential program for adolescent boys. And the second one is an innovative co-curricular program in an urban community college in New York City. And so the point is to emphasize the practical importance of conceptualizing human learning and development, issues of mind and identity, as profoundly social, dynamic, and agentic, activist, transformative processes. So the first work was a research project in a group home together with and for the benefit of boys growing up in the foster care system. And this was a residential program for abandoned or maltreated children. They suffered all kinds of abuse and neglect and at the ages of the child welfare system. And as you may know, youth growing up in child welfare programs, they encounter enormous obstacles that drastically hinder and limit their chances of creating equitable futures for themselves and to lead meaningful lives based on contribution to society. And the program was, in fact, in critical need for change as conflict was rampant and outcomes were dismal. Just to give you some quick overview, in 2010, there were approximately 750,000 children confirmed to be victims of maltreatment. Almost half a million children are currently living in the child welfare system in the United States, and minority children are disproportionately affected. As you can see, they're 41% of the children in the welfare system are white, when they are 53% of the child population, whereas almost 30% of the children in the child welfare system are African Americans, when they are, represent 24% of the overall child population. And child poverty in the US has reached the highest level in 2010 since 1993. 51% of all persons living in the US are below the estimated line of poverty. And children represent a disproportionate share of the U.S. poor. They are 24% of the total population, but they are 36% of the poor population. So as some more critically minded researchers in the child welfare system, which is actually not very common, I say that the U.S. Foster care is essentially a service for poor children. The problems necessitating placement have seldom been child-related. Instead, they have usually reflected the inadequacies in parental functioning commonly associated with poverty. So foster children, and what the research usually done by social workers, mainly based on correlational studies, documents poor developmental outcomes, a broad range of poor developmental outcomes for children in the welfare system. And typically, these issues are framed in terms of psychopathology, which amounts to a deficit view of the these children, so for example, with a quote here, that maltreated children's developmental trajectory is disproportionately compromised and leads to disproportionate involvement in the mental health, juvenile justice, and adult criminal justice and social service systems. And the prevailing viewpoint is that these children suffer from psychopathology, and therefore they need psychotherapy. So youth suffering from unidentified and socio-emotional disturbance may not be receiving appropriate mental health and social services. That's the focus, of the work with mainly social workers. Right? And there's nearly a unanimous consensus was reached in the 90s about the importance of addressing the clinical needs of youth. Right? So let me tell you a little bit about the plight of the residents when I came to work with them. And I had been working at a different program which was part of the same consortium of agencies, and I was doing evaluation work, and the director of the agency invited me to work as a psychologist for the group home. So these children, they had been removed from their families, usually due to social problems like substance abuse or their parents were incarcerated. Right? They had a history of multiple out-of-home placements. Right? And their lives were essentially controlled, right, by all these different professionals who really do not do a good job coordinating, right, all these different agencies. And these boys had they felt they had very limited participation in decision making about their lives and the lives of their families. And they were chastised for lagging behind in their academic achievement and for their quote unquote insufficiently developed motivation for school learning. Right? So what that meant is that they felt oppressed, and they sought ways to assert their severely constrained agency, insisting on making choices and resisting institutional rules. So, talk about what they... So they had their own agenda when I started in the program, right? And which was basically rebelling against the rules that they felt were imposed on them in a very authoritarian manner. Right? And the boys, unfortunately, reproduced a hierarchical system among themselves in which the tougher boys oppressed the younger peers who had to seek protection against bullying, forming alliances, usually short-lived and unstable. They adopted a strong individualist stance that was clearly manifest in their discourse. They talked about that they had to be tough, they had to fend for themselves and not let others take advantage of them. And they resisted school learning, which also was expressed in the accusations of their teachers' incompetence and discrimination against them. And they lacked a collective vision for transforming institutional practices. On the other hand, right, the staff had their own agenda. So they viewed the boys as undisciplined, disorderly, disrespectful, emotionally disturbed, and in need of structure. So they attributed to the boys problems to their history of abuse and neglect because of their dysfunctional families, which the boys in turn contested, right? And they blamed the staff, right, for making them angry because of their authoritarian ruling. So the staff understood their goal as to ensure the maintenance of institutional practices and compliance to its rules by controlling the boys through punitive measures and through clinical referrals and treatments. So you can just a summary of what I described. So basically, there was these two clashing agendas in the program, right? And which have been actually been very well documented in the literature. Right? There's a social worker who worked for decades on this, and he coined the phrase custodialism to describe, right, this vicious circle here, where, right, control leads to restricted agency and rebelliousness. So this antagonistic them versus us, right, power struggle. And moreover, I started to pay attention also to the meaning of learning, both for the boys and for the staff, which was quite contradictory. On the one hand, they would say that knowledge is power, right? So they expressing their belief in education as the great equalizer, right? But on the other hand, there was very little support for the boys to do their schoolwork. It's pretty much up to each one of them if they engaged that seriously or not. And as most did not, that seemed to confirm the staff's opinion about these boys' intrinsic lack of academic motivation and ability. The boys also engaged in their schoolwork very mechanically, not surprising given that their schoolwork did emphasize memorization and drills. Right? So the academic performance was pretty horrible. The boys were staying behind, not passing their classes, right? And it's interesting because I will soon move to how what I could do since I was caught up, right, in the midst of this, right, two competing agendas. And basically, what people were telling me that I couldn't do much, right? That I had to join in line and help control the boys, right? Which at first it took me a while to understand because it was so tense, so dramatic, the condition. And I felt so much for the boys that it took me a while to understand where the staff was coming from. You know, and I learned that the manager, and he was very authoritarian. And some people described the program as his fiefdom, right? Like it was his rule, he controlled it, right? But I understood that actually, for him, that was quite an accomplishment because the program was very chaotic and in disarray before he started that. So they really couldn't see much an alternative to that. And he told me a couple of times that I was wasting my time trying to help all the kids, I could work with the one or two who I were more interested, but all of them, right, that some of them don't want to be helped, and there's nothing that I could do because each individual is different, right? And some boys were simply not very bright. Right? So then I entered that site, right, with a vision for change, right? And I guess as it's obvious now, right, I could really not take an impartial position because the staff expected me, right, to clinically intervene, right, with the boys' problems and help them, right, with the goal of controlling the institution. The boys were well aware of the staff's expectations for my role there, right, and they didn't even want to talk with me. You know, some of the tougher boys, they wouldn't look at me in the beginning, so they rejected that. Right? Now, so based on a collectivist egalitarian ideal, I had a vision, right, that those power relations could be reconfigured. Right? And my ideal was that we could create an alternative learning context where emancipatory knowledge could be reclaimed as a tool for the boys to advance their own agency and activism. Right? And which also implied, related to the boys as active and therefore accountable agents whose positions was not only legitimate, but also the very basis to understand and transform their oppressive community practices. And so I took a position of solidarity with the boys, and I rejected the staff's approach, including its implications that the boys suffered from psychopathology. So I'm gonna step back a little bit just to talk about the theoretical framework, how this the Vygotskian cultural historical theory expanded by a transformative activist stance helped me move on with this project. Right? So these are some of the central tenets of cultural historical activity theory. The collaborative transformative activities aimed at transcending natural limitations. Right? Purposeful social interactions mediated by cultural tools are the foundation and source of human development. Right? So according to this approach, human communities draw on and expand the cultural tools, including the knowledge and skills embodied in social activities, right, acquired from previous generations, and pass them on to future generations. Right? And so therefore, cultural mediation is a central notion here in human development, that human individual mental processes arise in and from goal-directed activity through mastery and internalization of cultural tools. So, therefore, human development centrally involves learning, and to the extent that it involves mastering cultural tools through joint activities with more knowledgeable others. So perhaps the most well-known part of cultural historical activity theory is Vygotsky's work on connecting learning and development. That was embodied in this concept of the zone of proximal development. So Vygotsky posited that children can go beyond their current level of development by engaging collaborative activities with adult or more competent peers. Right? Therefore, properly organized instruction can lead development. So in this approach, the focus was how to arrange teaching and learning processes in such a way as to lead profound developmental changes. And this is actually a trend that developed mostly in Russia. I'm not gonna have time to talk about that now, but maybe in the discussion we can talk about the different trends in cultural historical activity theory. And Anna has written a lot about that too. So so following that trend, we could call that Igor Arievich calls systemic theoretical teaching and learning, which draws on the works of Galperin and Davidov. Right? So they took the notion of zone of proximal development a step further. Right? So especially Galperin focused on how the developmental impact of instruction is contingent on the quality of the instruction and the quality of the cultural tools. And in this approach, the focus is on teaching children theoretical concepts understood as a form of thinking, right, including abstraction and generalization, that allows students to understand the interconnections between the general and particularly in objects and phenomena through revealing their origins within systems of social practice. So the focus here is on designing cultural tools that specifically provide experiences in which the evolving histories and functions of these tools are made explicit and accessible so that the students can engage in and reenact meaningful activities embedded in these tools. So meaningful mastery of these tools, right, opened up new possibilities for acting and contributing to social practices. Right? And this And there's a slightly different version of this, but the point is that the ontological aspect of learning, right? That to learn means changes who you are as a person, right? That this, the deep connection between acting and knowing, right? As you know, you can do different things, and you participate, right, in social activities in a different way. So this has been well explored with by Jean Lave, but not so much in connection, right, with the cultural tools. So so working with Anna, then we went even another step further. So I'm going to talk about teaching and learning from a transformative activist stance. Right? So one way to further expand the tenets of Vygotsky's cultural historical activity theory on the role of teaching and learning is to link these processes to identity development and consider not only the present communal practices in their history, but the relevance of forward-looking activist positioning by the learners vis-a-vis the future of these practices, and of a commitment to social change in order to bring this future into reality. And for this activist stance to become instrumental at the intersection of learning and identity development, the cultural tools need to be recreated by students in light of their potential application in future practices by the students themselves as tools of their meaningful quests and therefore identity. And so again, according to a transformative activist stance, teaching and learning constitute the pathway for individuals to acquire the cultural tools that allow for contribution to society. And creating one's identity by finding one's place among other people and ultimately finding a way to contribute to the continuous flow of sociocultural practices. And then learning becomes personally transformative by providing tools for identity development and opening up new horizons for personal and social growth. So education is not about acquiring knowledge for the sake of knowing, but an active project of becoming a unique individual that contributes to social practice. Now obviously that contrasts, right, very starkly with these notions of mental health. So as I mentioned before, all the work on the child welfare literature is based on this notion of mental health. It's pervasive and ill-defined, right? So consequently, right, the focus is on mental pathology, which not only reinforces the notion that there's something intrinsically problematic about children growing up in child welfare programs, but it also perpetuates the gap between processes of teaching, learning, and development. So in a way, that was already my initial stance in the program, knowing, you know, these theories and having worked on this approach. I knew that I wanted to focus on teaching, learning, and development, not on clinical aspects. So it totally ignores, right, this view of mental health, the role of teaching and learning, and development, and it helps to create this vicious circle. So developmental opportunities for foster youth are limited insofar as an emphasis on treating psychopathology invariably relegates teaching and learning to a secondary place. So, so I talked about, right, the boys having their own agenda, the staff having their agenda, and I come in there also with my own, right, agenda. Right? So now I'm going to talk about how what I did, which is, right, taking the position, beginning with the position of solidarity with the boys, how I try to engage them, right, in developing a collective vision for how all of us, right, could transform that institution and break that vicious circle. So I started learning about and witnessing the boys' predicament, what Frege called the thematic universe of the oppressed, right, which includes understanding how they perceive their plight, right, for example, through their discourses on race and inequality, right, and their limit situations, right, which are Frege described as those that appear, right, as impossible to change. Right, and two themes stood out. The boys' desire to expand their agency and their frustration and even hopelessness over the possibility of changing their situation. Right? And I also began advocating for the boys, for example, mediating their conflicts with the staff, trying to avoid certain boys from being discharged from the institution, and I started to create different activities, novel activities in the institution, which provided opportunities for the boys to expand their agency, because these activities were collaborative. And we negotiated our common goals, for example, trips to New York City, to museums, and to watch movies. And then for about 6 months, we worked on a collective video project. So gradually, the boys came to regard my efforts as genuinely in line with their standpoint. Right? Though, I mean, I am summarizing here, it sounds like, right, there's like a smooth progression, but right, I think you can imagine that the process was quite fractured and a lot of drama. Right? And always requiring multiple negotiation of interests. But then they started to respect me, and also because, as I mentioned, the activities were democratically chosen, which at first the staff opposed. Right? They thought I shouldn't be doing that, right? I had to help control the boys. But anyway, so increasingly, that gave a hope to the boys that their situation could be changed, and that space could be created in the program for them to exercise their agency. So I began to invite them to develop a collective vision to together transform their community practices and break off that vicious cycle of control and rebelliousness. So initially, the activities, these collaborative activities, they were mostly around play, but gradually I started to embed learning goals in them. So they became learning active. I started helping them, tutoring with homework, right? And then I actually designed a series of workshops following, although only loosely, the principles of systemic theoretical instruction. So these collaborative activities became sites for a critical inquiry, where transforming community practices were posed as a collective problem for all of us to work together. So I just want to emphasize here that then my the researcher's endpoint, I opened up, right, rather than closed off, the process of knowing and constructing egalitarian community practices. And this included relying on the boys' expertise and knowledge, while also challenging and contesting some of their views, and simultaneously being challenged and contested by them too in pursuit of a common agenda. And in this process, all positions and claims to privilege were scrutinized, including boys' reliance on dominant cultural discourses and biases, as well as the researchers, my own position and vision. Right? So what this led to was what Anna and I are calling a critical theoretical teaching and learning approach, right? That draws both on systemic theoretical teaching learning and critical pedagogy. And the main point is to provide conceptual tools for youth to define their present location within social practices and understand their key contradictions while developing a collective vision and endpoint about how to transform those practices and themselves. Okay, so I'm just going to summarize very briefly the transformative role of critical theoretical knowledge. So with that approach, that the boys could examine and reflect on their own stance, right, toward contradictions in their community practices, while drawing systematic connections among histories and layers in social practices and exploring possibilities for a collective agency. So just to give you an example, so we had a reading group, and the boys, the older boys, were reading Frege and the Pedagogy of the Oppressed. So that's just an example, right, of some critical theoretical concepts, right, that I introduced, right, to them. So this critical analysis, mediated by theoretical concepts, allowed the boys to recognize how they and the staff were locked in that additive misconception of empowerment, in which gains in agency on one side implied loss of agency on the other. And this instigated the boys to reimagine their community practices in a way that would expand their agencies in synergistic ways. Right? So so through those workshops and another one, I had a friend who was a graphic designer, and she wanted to volunteer in the program. So we had a series of workshops that we started with a history of logos and how design evolved, right, as a tool for targeting for consumerism, but and also how it could be reappropriated, right, by activists, right, and by propaganda. So Yeah, so at that point, critical theoretical teaching line had emerged as a central activity in the program, driven by the boys' own desire to acquire conceptual tools for empowerment and social change. So what happened at that point is that the boys became really interested in learning, and things began to change. After a couple of years, there was like a critical mass was reached, and you know, then big change actually happened quite fast. So insofar as these concepts enabled the boys to see the possibility of change and the practical value to what they used to view as useless abstract knowledge, they became tools of identity and agency by spurring the activist positioning toward educational practices and to society in general. And so let me give some examples of what changed. Right? So first of all, right, this project transformed the meaning of learning from them. So generalized concept, right, that they used to relate to as abstract, useless, meaningless, right, were demystified and turned into meaningful activity. So reading Frege's work was key to helping the boys master theoretical generalizations as tools to systematically relate a range of apparently disconnected observations and experiences. So they could draw links between the pedagogical practices, right, that they were exposed to in their schools and the learning outcomes. Right? And many boys found Frege's concept of the banking type of education, right, the assumption that knowledge can be deposited into individual heads, right, very revealing. It allowed them to transform their understanding of the educational shortcomings from solely an individual failure, right, to the instantiation of a societal problem embedded in a broad system of historically institutionalized inequitable social relations and practices. And the boys began to develop a new vision. They began to grasp that sheer resistance might be self-defeating because it reinforced the staff's view that they suffered from emotional disturbances and in effect sustained the existing status quo. It helped them recognize how they and the staff, right, were locked in that power struggle. And I think I mentioned this already, so I can... okay, so as the boys embraced learning as a meaningful activity, right, and which improved their, led to an improvement in their academic performance at school, right, even their grades and retention rates, all of that changed dramatically. Right? So that transformation undermined the staff's thematic universe that the boys had, right, intrinsic problems that they couldn't change. That, right? So in fact, right, the staff's deficit view that the boys and their pessimism about the possibility of change began to crack. Right? So one of the most significant changes was that the boys began to demand changes in the structure of the program and its institutional rules, such as different schedule for study time and requesting more space for them to carry out their learning activities. Right? I think this is the last one. So basically, that vicious cycle was we're dismantling that vicious cycle together. Right? And gradually, the boys' desire for a more comfortable, more peaceful, and democratic home, right, where they were respected and their voices heard, began to be realized. Staff and boys began to see each other more as allies, which strengthened their sense of community. Incidents of non-compliance with the program rules decreased. Punitive actions by the staff sharply decreased too, leading to fewer conflicts. And a new daily routine was established, and the boys stopped running away from the program. So from having cleaner facilities to having more varied activities relevant to the boys, right, from being capable of and interested in learning to gaining the staff's respect and investment in them, a novel and more democratic community practice took root in the program. I guess I think I'm done with my time, right? So I will not talk about the program, so we can have time for discussion.
Yes, any questions people have?
Thanks. Anna, you were talking about mainstream psychology today.
Yes.
And I have my own thoughts about this, but I'm wondering what your thoughts are about what happened to and what currently is happening with the what might be called the third force in psychology, the humanistic psychologists, and that whole movement that really ties in with what you're both, yeah. the approach that you're both taking.
Well, this is working. Yes, is it? I don't know. Is it? Yes? Okay. Yeah. Well, yes, there are interesting parallels, of course. I mean, it's interesting you mentioned the notion of third force. There is also the notion I like, which is called the second psychology. The second psychology. So it's not the same as the third force as a separate humanist direction in psychology. But second psychology, this is by Sheldon White, who was a mainstream, you can say, psychologist working at Harvard and then really critiquing the field and the discipline. And by second psychology, he meant really people who worked on the transactional notions, including Bronfenbrenner, by the way, so who I never mentioned once here today, but certainly, definitely you could expand the second psychology and the third force as these alternative forces, yes, working against the mainstream narrow approach. There have not been done enough connections, I think, between this second psychology and the third force. Let's use the metaphor. If you mean the contemporary works in humanist tradition, there are different, of course. There's very different directions. There are works by Shiksha Mahaili, they, on the one hand, I don't know if you, or you work maybe with any particular framework, you would refer to as something that you are using? Yeah, just to see where you are situated.
Well, I've kind of grown through a lot of what started in the 60s and all the experiential and structured experiences and
yes.
that background. And
okay.
So my project, you could say, my life project is in creating large-scale learning communities and model for living that incorporates a lot of what you're talking about.
Well, I see. That's certainly. I think it's good if we see each other as allies first of all, because we need each other.
Absolutely.
Yes. There needs to be more theoretical work to connect them at the level of very broad theory of human development and learning. I think there needs more of that work that draws on these similarities and synergies and highlights them. And part of my work is exactly in this direction. To really see where the connections are and where there are differences as well. So that, for example, a transformative activist stance, it takes not the notion of experience as a phenomenological experiencing, but a more active notion of a contribution and the deed in the Bhakti and the Gotsky tradition, mm-hmm. which supersede the notion of experiencing. For example, I'm saying it very briefly. So there are also conceptual differences, but they fade in comparison to how important it is to draw these allies a little more closely together in light of this tsunami of the biologically reductivist view of the brain. So it's very unfortunate we know little about each other and don't use each other's words.
Yes.
So one of the message here, my presentation, the whole message is solidarity for the works that resist the reductivist